Good morning and welcome to Faith Christian Fellowship Online. Thank you for joining us this morning as we praise our Lord.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Praise Him.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your
Jesus is the one who breaks the power of sin and darkness. This virus has no hold on us, so don't give up. Don't give in. Don't give up. For our God is great. He will endure.
Our God, and all will see how great
Well, good morning. Well, before we do our confession, I would like to get us into a state of God consciousness, and the word righteousness has been on my mind all week. Last week we talked about God is going to do a new thing. We're not to remember the former things, but God says, I'm going to do a new thing, and we have to set our minds on the things of the Spirit. So in contemplating this word righteousness, it's not in the confession, and yet it is the foundation of the confession. So the scripture says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, for our sake he became sin who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So in Christ, all our sins are taken away, and in Christ, we now have God's righteousness. That makes us strong. That's where our strength lies, when we are righteous before God. And if we can get that into our consciousness, then we won't be sin conscious, darkness conscious, whatever the devil's doing, we're not conscious of those things. We rise above that and we become God conscious. Jesus paid the price so that we would be new creations in him. Just a few verses before that, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. So we want to just get that into our thinking and into our spirits, that we are righteous. That is the foundation of our authority against the powers of darkness and the devil. That is also the foundation of our place in Christ, where we are powerful. Now, the church has been weak. The church is just kind of hanging in there for too long, and the devil's been doing all kinds of things. But the church needs to rise up and be all that Christ has bought and paid for the church to rise up and be all that it was called to be. And even as individuals, we need to come to the place where we're secure in Christ. We are bold in him. We are strong in him. And that leads me to Romans 17. If because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. That talks about reigning as kings and priests. So through the abundance grace of grace and the free gift of righteousness, we are reigning. We're not just existing. We're not just hanging in there. We reign. And so righteousness is the bottom line. The blood has been shed. Our sins are washed away. We are new creatures in Christ. And so even beyond our confession, we need to know the courage that God has given us, the freedom God has given us, the strength he gives us. And if we're not filled with the Spirit, we need to get filled with the Spirit. And if we're half empty, then let's get all the way full, because God is waiting on his church to rise up. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And now in this time, even though we're isolated and we're not getting together, it's a real good time to get in the Word, get yourself full of the Word, get soaked in the Word, get in the presence of God. In his presence is fullness of joy, in his right hand are pleasures forevermore. It's a time where we can get prepared, because I believe ahead is a great awakening, a great revival. God wants to do a new thing, but let's get ready. Let's get on fire for him. Let's get be vigilant. It also, in Ephesians 6, it talks about putting on the full armor of God, and one of those is put on the breastplate of righteousness. So when we put on the armor of God, there is no Goliath that's going to stand. When David had the armor of God, and he didn't have Saul's armor, he had the blood of Jesus, and he had a covenant with the living God, and That's why Goliath didn't have a chance. And the devil doesn't have a chance if we know our covenant rights and privileges, if we know who we are in Christ, then the devil doesn't have a chance, and we are more than conquerors. So let's put on the armor of righteousness, the breastplate of righteousness, and all of the other armor of God, and we can reign in life through Christ Jesus. And that's the price he paid so we would come to a high level in God. So let's be real God conscious. Let's be real righteous conscious. And the devil is a defeated foe. He can't stand against us. And the church will become powerful more and more as we as individual believers rise up and be all that God has called us to be. Let's do our confession together. I am blessed. I am redeemed. I am forgiven. I am loved. I am healed. I am free. I am prosperous. I am talented. I am creative. I am confident. I am secure. I am disciplined. I am focused. I am prepared. I am qualified. I am determined. I am equipped. I am empowered. I am motivated. I am valuable. I am anointed. I am accepted and approved. I am not average, not mediocre. I am a child of the Most High God, and I will become all that I was created to be. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and that we reign through Christ Jesus when we are mindful of the covenant of the blood that was shed. We're mindful of the righteousness that he bought and paid for us. Our sins have been removed from us. All that the devil put on us and all that the flesh could do has all been crucified. We've been crucified with Christ, and now we live in him and through him, and in the power of the Spirit, we will be all that you have called us to be. Thank you for a new consciousness of God, and a new consciousness of God in us, and a new consciousness of righteousness, the righteousness of God. And we praise and we thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to Faith Christian Fellowship. Thank you for being part of our online service. It's always a privilege and an honor to come into your home and share God's word with you. I just want to give a shout out to all those that were part of our week of fasting and prayer last week. It's just a wonderful time to draw close to God. And we know that the more we give ourselves to the Word of God and to prayer, the more God's able to turn things around in our lives. And also, fasting is awesome for getting the sugar out of our system after eating all the chocolates and all the special food over this last little while. Also, I want to thank you for your generosity and your kindness in giving to the Kenya Project. And Reverend Jenny Roberts thanks you as well for your kindness. And we just know that God will bless you for your generosity and for your faithfulness to make a difference in the nation of Kenya. We all had negative things happen to us in 2020. But this here is a new year. And it's a new opportunity to give thanks to God and to serve Him. And we need to know that regardless of what happened last year, what went wrong, what plans didn't work out, we just need to have it settled in our mind that our God is faithful. He's looking after us, and He has good things in store. I want to read from Isaiah 43, verse 18, and it says, "Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing." And what that means is, just don't bring the baggage, the negative baggage of 2020 into 2021. As long as you and I are dwelling in the past, we're going to miss the new things God wants to do in the future. Remember Lot's wife? God was delivering them out of Sodom and Gomorrah, delivering them from judgment, bringing them into a place of freedom. But she just couldn't keep looking ahead. She looked back. And she, the Bible says she lingered there, and she looked back. And God doesn't want us to look back in that sense that we're stuck in the past, that we're a prisoner of the past. He wants to bring us into the future that He has for us, because God wants us to know that our best days are not behind us. Our best days are right in front of us. And so God's plan is to increase you like never before, and to take you places that you could never get to on your own. He has great things in store for you, and He wants you and I to come up higher in 2021 in our relationships, in our finances, in our health, and of course in our walk with the Lord. As you draw near to Him, He will draw near to you. God is a big God. He's an unlimited God, and He has new things coming your way in 2021. I just want you to get that in your spirit. I want you to believe that. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank You for an opportunity to call out on Your name, to come close to You. We recognize that You are an unlimited God. You're a big God. You're a very faithful God. And we recognize that You sit in the heavens, and that the nations are but a drop in the bucket as far as You're concerned, that You are the one that can control everything and anyone if we will just allow You. And so we just put our future into Your hands. We put this year that we've stepped into Your hands, and we know that You will look after us in grand style. And Father, for those that are worried, those that, Father, have anxiety, those, Father, that are concerned about the future, I just, Father, ask that You instruct them in the way they should go. You just bring them hope and let them know that as they cast their care upon You, as they commit their future to You, that, Father, Your peace will be their portion, and that You will make a way where there's no way. I just declare, Lord Jesus, just help them realize that if they can keep their mind stayed on You, You will keep them in perfect peace. And Father, for those that are dealing with any kind of sickness or disease, I thank You, Lord Jesus, that we don't have to beg You to help us. That 2,000 years ago, the same time that Jesus put away our sins, He put away our diseases by His stripes. And so I thank You, Father, that by the stripes of Jesus, we were healed. And if we were healed, we are healed. We are the redeemed of the Lord, and we say so. I thank You, Father, that You're opening new doors of opportunity for us this coming year in 2021, and we are in expectation of what You are about to do, and we know that You always do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything we could ask, think, or even dare to imagine. I want to thank You for Your generosity and for Your faithfulness to bring Your tithes and offerings here. And we just know that God will reward you, that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. He said in His Word that if we would give, it would be given to us good measure, shaken together, running over, would men give to us. And our God is faithful. He is the one that takes care of us. He's the one that sustains us. Actually, He is our source. We remind ourselves constantly that our job is not our source, that our career is not our source, our business is not our source. God is our source, and He is an unlimited God. And as we're preparing ourselves to give to Him today, I just want you to know that He is faithful. If God has said something, He will surely bring it to pass in your life and in my life. I would encourage you just simply to go online and go to our website, fcfchurch.ca, and simply click on the Give button. We have some options there to make your giving to Faith Christian Fellowship easy, safe, and secure. First of all, we have e-transfers that can be sent to FCF, or sent to Faith Christian Fellowship, by emailing fcfgive@mymts.net. Also, if you belong to the Access Credit Union, you can give to the church through the Pay Bill section. If you prefer to give by mail, you can mail your donation to the address on the screen. Also, if you would like to bring your donation or your gift to the church, you can do so during regular office hours. We believe that every tither and every giver will experience God's very best. Let's pray and let's believe God that He will show Himself strong in our finances in this coming year in unprecedented ways. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You that Your Word never fails, that You watch over Your Word to perform it. You said that if we would bring our tithes and offerings into the storehouse, that You would open the windows of heaven over our lives and pour out blessings that we couldn't even begin to contain. You would rebuke the devourer for our sake. And Father, I thank You for rebuking the devourer over our lives, over our business, over our career, over our families, that You, Father, are protecting us. You have a hedge around us because we are tithers and givers. I thank You, Father, that it is the blessing of the Lord that makes us rich, and You add no sorrow with it. I thank You, Father, that You are the one that meets our needs according to Your riches in glory through one Christ Jesus. Our eyes are on You. We're expecting You to open new doors of opportunity that no man can shut. Thank You for giving us creative ideas, witty inventions, and new ways to increase. I thank You, Father, that as we meditate on Your Word, on Your promises, day and night, and we refuse to allow those words to depart from our lips, that You will cause everything that we put our hand to prosper and to have good success. And we thank You for it. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. I want to talk to you today about having an overflow mentality or an overflow mindset. If you're wondering how this new year is going to play out, I want you to know that no matter how difficult the circumstances that you face this coming year, no matter how hard things may seem to be, or how long it's taking for things to turn around for your good and for God's glory, that God is still on the throne. God does not stop every difficulty, and He doesn't keep us from every challenge that we face. But here's what I want you to know. There is no problem that God can't help you overcome. There's no heartache that He cannot heal. There is no storm that He cannot bring you through. When I think of 2020, the last year, people kept saying over and over again, 2020, the year like no other. Here's what I want to get in your spirit, that we have a God like no other. He's a faithful God. He's a big God. He is a generous God. He is a very present help in our time of trouble, and He always leads us to triumph. So we serve a God like no other. There's no God like our God. Greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. John 10:10 is from the words of Jesus, says, "The thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you may have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full until it overflows." Here we see that there's two families. There's the family of God and there's the family of Satan. There's the kingdom of God, there's the kingdom of darkness. There are the works of God, there are the works of the enemy. There are thoughts that come from God, there are thoughts that come from the enemy. And here we know this is God's will. God's word is God's will. And we see that God's will is that He has created us to live an abundant life. No matter who we are, no matter where we are, and no matter what's wrong with the world that we're living in. In Psalm 19, God is rehearsing what he has done in the life of David. David had been surrounded by his enemies, and he had been trapped by King Saul. And in Psalm 19, David is rejoicing and thanking God that God had delivered him out of the hand of all of his enemies, delivered him out of the hand of King Saul, his father-in-law, and not only had he delivered him out of the hand of his enemies and out of the hand of King Saul, but he delivered him into a large place, into an enlarged place, into a spacious place. He not only got him out, but he brought him into abundance. He brought him into overflow. Let's read this. Psalm 18, verse 19 says, "He brought me forth also into a large place." That's God's dream for you, that he would bring you and I into a large place, into an abundant life. But even though he has a big life in store, if we have limited thinking, we're going to live a limited life. We had some friends that went golfing in a rural golf course, and of course on the golf carts they had governors on them. The engine in those little golf carts could go a lot faster. The golf carts could go a lot faster than what they were able to do on the golf course because there was a governor on them. And so these guys were kind of mechanical. And so when they got out into the golf course and they were about the only ones out there, they started tinkering with that governor, and they got those golf carts where they could really go fast, and they just had a great time flying around about three or four times faster than what it would regularly go. And that's what our mind does. Even though the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in our spirit, the amount of power that flows out of our life has to go through our mind. And if our mind is not thinking right, if our minds are religiously brainwashed instead of New Testament taught, then we will short-circuit that power. The same wisdom that created the heavens and earth dwell within us. We have the mind of Christ in our spirit. But that wisdom to be operating in our lives, our mind has to come into agreement with what God has put in our spirits. And so our minds determine, in many cases, how much God is able to do in our lives. If we have a limited mindset, then we're going to live a very limited life. God's dream is that we don't have a small mentality and that we don't water down our dreams, because God wants us to know that he's created us for more than what we are experiencing right now. If you put a plant in a pot that's too small for it, that plant will never reach its full potential because the roots can't grow. And that's what happens when our thoughts are not in line with God's thoughts. We stunt ourselves. We limit the unlimited one from working in our lives. David said, "My cup is full and it runs over." Our God is an overflowing God. He wants his blessings. He wants his health. He wants his power. He wants his wisdom. He wants his grace not only to flow to us, but he wants it to flow through us to others so that we can be a great blessing. But we have to understand that we are children of a God who loves us and who wants to elevate us and bring us into overflow and into abundance. God is called El Shaddai, the God who's more than enough. He's not the God of just barely enough. He's the God of more than enough. He is the one that wants to bring us into abundance. He wants to bring us into overflow. Psalm 35 says it like this, "Let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified who has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants." In other words, God had his people repeat this constantly, that he was pleased with prospering them. And he said that over and over again because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. He wanted them to understand that he wanted them blessed. This is what pleases him. This is what honors him. This is what blesses him when his children are experiencing his goodness, his favor, that his goodness and mercy are following them all the days of their lives. That's why when we begin our services that Vern brings the confession week after week about who we are in Christ, what we have in Christ, what we can do in Christ. And why we go over that is so that we can be confident in our minds that we are who God says we are. And honestly, we do have what God says we have, so that when God wants to work in our lives, that we don't limit him. We don't resist him, that we come into agreement with him and allow God to be God in our lives. Your life is moving towards what you're constantly thinking about. And if you're constantly thinking about thoughts of lack, not enough, struggle, I'm never going to make it, I don't know how it's going to work out, your life will move in the wrong direction. God did not create us just to get by in life, not just to have what we need, not just us four and no more. He wants us to have an abundance so that we can be a blessing to others. He's blessed us to be a blessing. Our minds must be changed to think in line with what God has promised us, because we'll never become any greater than what we think. We must take responsibility for what we think, because our thoughts control our lives. That's why the Bible says over and over again, take thought what you think. Think upon these things. Think upon whatsoever is lovely, whatsoever is pure, whatsoever is of a good report. Why do we do that? Because we have to think about what we think about. And what we think about is going to be the direction our life is going to flow. What you think about becomes your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your habits. Your habits become your character, and your character becomes your destiny. That's why it's so important to think thoughts that do not limit God, that do not hinder God, that do not stop God from being God in our circumstance. Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as he or she thinks, so is he or she." You and I become what we think. Your life will always move in the direction of your strongest thoughts. That's why you have to think right before you live right. Your thoughts become your future. So I have a couple thoughts that I would encourage you to make strongholds in your life. First of all, God's greatest exploits in your life are in your future and not your past. In other words, your best days are not behind you. Your best days are always right in front of you. And again, we look back at 2020. It was a very negative situation for so many people. Maybe somebody did you wrong, or maybe the company let you go last year. The pandemic brought changes and disruptions that no one saw coming. Some of us lost loved ones. Some of us lost our job, lost a business, lost a career, lost finances during this pandemic. But don't believe the lies that things are not going to get better. Our attitude should be that this thing came, but it came to pass. It did not come to stay. That it's God's goodness and mercy that follow us all the days of our lives. And we have to believe that what we have left is enough for God to do what he needs to do in our lives. In the Old Testament, there was a 3.5-year drought in Israel because the king had built an idol. And the Lord told Elijah to go to a town called Zarephath, where he had commanded a widow. And this widow was not a follower of God. She didn't believe in God. She didn't know God. But God had worked in her life. Obviously, she called out to God for help. And God's no respecter of persons. When we come to God, and we come to God with the right attitude, God will answer us. God will move in our behalf. And so Elijah went outside of Israel, outside of his people, and went into what we would call a heathen nation, and was able to be a blessing to someone there who didn't know God, but had made contact with God. And this widow that God had spoken to in this foreign land was going to provide food for Elijah. Now, without an overflow mindset, Elijah would have felt sorry for himself by being sent to such a destitute widow. But instead, he asks her for a cup to bring him a little water. And she starts to get him some water. It's so amazing to me that here's this little widow, and she's in famine, and she doesn't know this prophet from Adam. And he comes and he asks her for a cup of water. And you know, she doesn't give him any lip. She doesn't say, go get it yourself. She doesn't say, look, you don't understand what I'm going through. You get your own water. She immediately started to get some water. And as she starts to get it, he says, could you get me a little bit of food too? Can you get me a little bit of bread to eat? And then she tells him her story. And she tells him that she just has enough olive oil. She has just enough flour to make a little cake. And she's going to bake it. And she's going to feed it to her son. And this is going to be their last meal on earth. And then they're just going to eventually die of starvation. That was what her situation was. You know, she wasn't one of those ones that had been hoarding up toilet paper and all kinds of canned goods in her garage. She was down to nothing. But I want you to know that when we're down to nothing, God is always up to something good. He sees us. He is an ever-reaching God. He is faithful to look after us in grand style. You know, you would think this situation that she was in, down to her last meal, that this would be hard on her mental health. It would play on her emotions, that she would be what we would call a basket case, because that she would be stressed out, that she would be just so burdened down. But here she is, a blessing. It's so amazing that even though she was not what we would call a follower of God, she's overcoming and master evil with good. And she's getting herself off her mind. She's sowing a seed to meet her need. And so during this pandemic that we're in, there's been a lot of fear, a lot of anxiety, and a lot of mental distress. In fact, people are saying that the mental distress and disorder that we are experiencing today is going to be even greater than the financial fallout, than the physical fallout of this pandemic. In fact, the U.S. National Center of Health contrasted the emotional state of people as of July 2019, and they said that 8% of American adults showed signs of anxiety disorder. Fast forward to July of 2020, 36% of adults showed signs of anxiety disorder. One expert says that we are in the midst of a mental health epidemic right now, and he says, I believe it's only going to get worse. You know, anxiety, stress, and worry are a result of what we're thinking about all the time. But so is God's peace and God's joy and God's favor. Those attributes, those fruits are a result of what we think about all the time as well. Our minds must be convinced that our God is a God of overflow and that He'll meet all of our needs according to His riches, regardless of who we are, regardless of where we came from, and regardless of what challenge that we're presently in. Most of life's battles are won or lost in our minds. There's a battlefield in the mind, and that's why wrong thinking is really the worst enemy that we have as believers and followers of Christ. The widow told Elijah what she had left, not what she used to have. You know, the Bible doesn't even tell us when she lost her husband, how she lost her husband, doesn't tell us any of the details about all the things that she suffered. All that she recorded is what she had left. That is so amazing. Many times when we're going through a hard time, many times when we are struggling in life, what we tell people is what we lost. We tell people what we used to have. We tell people about better days in the past and how bad it is today and how impossible it is today. This woman was an amazing woman. She never mentioned anything about what she lost. She just shared with the prophet what she had left. I think of when this pandemic started and we were having to go online, and my first thought is, oh my goodness, we used to have a studio. We used to have a 3-camera system. We used to have all kinds of equipment, new equipment. And then I was thinking, what good is that? How does that help us? God can't work with that. God can't do anything with what we don't have. God can only work with what we do have. And then Brittany came and she helped us with her camera, and others came and helped us. But God takes what we have left, and then he takes it and he multiplies it, just like with the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes that fed 5,000 families. It's amazing. They didn't have much, but God didn't need a lot. He just needed what they had. And he needs to work with what we've got left. And so this woman, she's not talking about her aches and pains. She's not talking about what she's lost. She's talking about what she has left. And that is something, I don't know if I could do that in her situation, but she did. She knew the principle that we must all operate in, and that is God doesn't need what we don't have, but he'll use what we have to move us right into overflow. God will always use what we have left. She only had a handful of meal. She only had just a little bit of olive oil, and that's all she needed to activate God's overflow in her life. It's amazing, isn't it? In 1 Kings 17:13, it says, Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go ahead and do what you have said, but make a little bread for me first. Then use what's left over to prepare a meal for yourself and your son." It's amazing to me that here she's not what we would call a covenant woman. She's not what we would call a Bible believer. And here she's operating in the principles. Jesus said, if you would seek me first, if you would put the kingdom of God first, I would add all these things that you need. He said, the scriptures say in Proverbs 3, that if you will bring the first fruits of your income, then I will fill you with plenty. And here's this woman, she is bringing her first. He said to her, bring me what's first. Bring me the first portion, and I'll bless you. It's such a principle. Then use what's left to prepare a meal for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, there will always be flour and olive oil left in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the crops grow again. You know, our natural tendency is when we're down to just about nothing, we're going to hold on to what we have and give God what's left, which is nothing. You know, during the pandemic, many times people, instead of giving God his first portion, They keep it for themselves because this is when we need it. No, this is when we need to get it in God's hand more than any other time in our lives. When we're in the time of struggle, when they're in the time of distress, when we're in the time of trial, that's the time we need God involved in our finances. That's the time we need God involved in our health. That's the time we need God involved in our relationships. And so God sometimes has your provision in the hands of an unbeliever. You know, God will use whoever he wants to use. The scriptures say that the wealth of the unjust is laid up for the righteous, for the godly, for God's people. Sometimes God will even use somebody who does not believe what you believe to be a blessing to you. I just heard the other day, or I think I read, we read it the other day on an email, that a church that we went to last year or 2 years ago in Florida, they operate out of a school. They don't have their own building yet, so they operate out of a school. And somebody stole, I think it was $35,000 worth of equipment. And so they posted it that someone had stolen it. And if they could just have a little help, you know, if somebody who could help them out. And here somebody didn't belong to the church, wasn't part of the congregation, I don't even think they were believers. Somebody just wrote a check for $35,000 that they didn't even know. You know, we can't limit God. We don't know who God will use. We don't know what God will do. Our part is to do our part, and that's to put God first. In Luke 4, verse 24, Jesus had gone to Jerusalem, and he had been invited to minister at the church in Jerusalem. And of course, it was full of Pharisees and full of all kinds of doctors of the law. And after the service was over, they rebuked Jesus and they said, why didn't you do miracles here like you've done in Capernaum? And Capernaum and all these other places, Jesus had gone and preached the gospel. And even though they were outsiders, even though they didn't know the covenant, when they heard the word, they acted on the word. But when Jesus was ministering to the religious people, they were offended. They said, who is this guy? This is Jesus. We know his father. He's the son of a carpenter. We know his mom. We know his brothers and sisters. He's a nobody. We're not going to receive from him. And they were saying, like, why couldn't you operate in the supernatural on our behalf? And of course, it was because they had limited the unlimited. Their thinking was that people get what they deserve. And this is where Jesus began to talk in Luke 4. And he says, don't you remember the days of Elijah during his ministry? There was a drought and there was a famine that lasted for 3.5 years. And Elijah was sent not to any of the widows in Israel. It said there was many widows in Israel that had a covenant in that time. But they didn't call out for help. They didn't come to God as their helper. You know, God has promised to be a husband to the widow. He's promised to be a father to the orphan. And so, obviously, the widows in Israel, the people that should have known better, they didn't look to God as their helper. They were disappointed. They maybe were angry with God, but they didn't call out to God. And here somebody outside had called out and they got helped. And of course, the religious people, when Jesus mentioned that, they were so upset because they think that we receive from God what we deserve. No, we don't get what we deserve from God. Everything we get from God, we receive by grace through faith. And it was the grace of God that caused this outsider to come in and to use what she had. And so sometimes God will use the most unlikely people to be a blessing to you. Your miracle begins when you stop feeling sorry for yourself and you go and help somebody else. In verse 15, the Bible says, so she did as Elijah said. That's the key. You know, God and his word are one. If we're going to get help from God, we're going to get help from his word. If we're going to obey God, we're going to obey his word. When we put God's word in action, God goes into action. And this is what happened, is this woman had heard the word. She had heard that God was going to work through her to bring provision to Elijah. I don't know how she heard it. The Bible doesn't say. But the Bible does say that he'd already commanded her to sustain Elijah during this season of drought, this season of famine. And God was faithful. And she was faithful. And she went out and did it. Can you imagine? She's down to her last meal. And she takes that little bit of meal and olive oil, and she makes what she needs for Elijah. She does that first. God is so faithful. And she did it. And goes on to say in verse 16, there was always enough flour and olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. You know, it's easy to give when we have more than we need. But this amazing woman had a generous, abundant spirit that was able to bring her through a time just like we're going through right now and bring her into abundance. Revival begins when you and I stop looking back at what we lost and start looking forward to the future that God has in store for us in spite of past hurts, past disappointments, and past problems. You and I must be convinced that our God is a God of increase and that He has something bigger in your future than He's ever had in your past. If you're going to live this large life, it starts in your thinking. Limited thinking will cause you and I to live a limited life. You may be in a limited circumstance, just like Elijah and this foreign widow were in, but just because we're in a limited circumstance that's beyond our control doesn't mean that we have to live a limited life. You may be in a limited circumstance, but the key is don't allow that limited circumstance to get into your thinking. That may be where you are, but that's not who you are. You are a child of God, and God is faithful. The Creator of the universe has something big in your future, according to Psalm 18, verse 19. He will not only bring you out of what you're in, but He'll bring you into abundance. He'll bring you into overflow, just like He did with David, just like He did with Elijah and this widow here. His will is to bring you into a wide, spacious life. That means a life free of addictions and bad habits, a life where you're healthy, whole, and fulfilled, a life of abundance, and a life of overflow. The enemy wants to contain you, but God wants to enlarge your life by enlarging your thinking. Who would have ever thought that this destitute widow, who didn't even have a covenant with God, would be a blessing to God's prophet during a time of famine and doubt? This woman experienced overflow in a time of famine and drought because she washed her hands, wore a mask, and stayed at home. No, she entered into overflow because she had a generous, abundant overflow mindset. God only wants to meet, not only wants to meet your needs this year, but He is an overflow God, a God of more than enough, who can make you a major blessing and a channel of His abundance. The scripture says in Malachi 3, when you honor God with your income, when you give your tithe, the first 10% of your salary, God will open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. That is the overflow that God has promised to every tither. And many of you have been faithful. You have given, you have served, and you have helped others. I'm asking you to get your hopes up. Get ready for overflow. Get ready for blessings that you cannot contain. You qualified yourself. You don't have to know how God's going to do it. You don't have to know who God is going to work through to bring the overflow to you. And you don't know where it's going to happen. All you have to do is believe that God is who He says He is, and He'll do what He says He'll do. I'm sure this destitute little woman had no idea all the things that God was going to do for her and through her as she shared that little bit of meal and that little bit of water. You know, God's not limited by your job. He's not limited by your salary or where your family came from. He knows how to increase you right where you are. One idea, one contract, one inheritance will put you into God's overflow. Why don't you say, God, I'm in agreement with you. I believe you have a wide, spacious, abundant life for me. I'm believing that my whole family will serve you. I'm believing to pay my house off. I'm believing to get totally well. I'm believing to start my own business. I'm believing to meet the person of my dreams. It's time to have an overflow mindset. Just like Elijah and this destitute widow, where you are spiritually and where you are financially is not where you're supposed to stay. Your destiny's calling out to you. It's time to start living large. Quit believing that you have reached your limits or you've made too many mistakes, because this is a new day. This is a new season. The things that God has in store for you are greater than anything that you have ever experienced in your past. God never does His greatest feats in your yesterdays. They're always in your future. You know, in this season, I want you to keep your hopes up. I want you to know that right where you are now, God wants to enlarge you. He wants to help you. He wants to bring you into abundance. And He wants to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything that you would ask, think, or even dare to imagine. Just remember, in your time of trouble, that no weapon formed against you will prosper. And that if God be for you, what difference does it make who or what has come against you? So in your time of trial, get your thinking moving in the right direction and become overflow minded. In your worst days, you must believe that your best days are not behind you, but they are right in front of you, and that God will use what you have left to enlarge you and bring you to a place of overflow and abundance. I want to pray for you. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that our last days are going to be better than our former days, that our best days are right in front of us. Father, I thank you that whether it's anxiety, worry, depression, fear, financial issues, marriage issues, physical issues, I thank you, Father, that your name is greater. Thank you, Lord, that we will finish the good work that you started in our lives. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. This widow was outside of God's covenant, and yet God found her. I want you to know that God's eyes are searching throughout the earth today. He's looking for somebody that He can cooperate with, somebody He can partner with, somebody He can join forces with. He wants to bring as many people into His family as He possibly can. And all He asks is that we call upon His name. The Bible says if we would call upon the name of the Lord, we would be saved. You think, well, don't we have to change our lifestyle? Don't we have to jump through some hoops? No, we don't have to. Everything is by grace through faith. All we need to do is to call on Him and believe that what Jesus did when he died on the cross was enough to make us right with God. Now, if you want to make a commitment to the Lord, I would encourage you, just pray with me. And just repeat these words after me, and just release your faith. And as you do, you'll really come into overflow. You'll come out of the kingdom of darkness, and you'll be translated right into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you for your great love and for the gift of Jesus to the world. Thank you that you willingly went to redeem us and to save us. Thank you that you saved us from all our sins. And we believe in our heart that you died for our sins and that you were raised the third day for our salvation. We confess with our mouth that you are now our Lord, you're our Savior. Fill us with your Spirit so that we may serve you all the days of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you prayed that simple prayer in faith and you meant it, you're a child of God in the family of God. So welcome to the family. We have some information that we'd like to send you that'll help you grow in your faith. And I would just encourage you, get in a good church, read your Bible, and pray, and God will begin to bring you into the fullness of what he has in store for you. Thanks again for being part of our service. We trust that you'll have a great week. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.